Good morning and happy Sunday. How is everybody doing? Well, are you doing good? Wonderful. Happy St. Patrick's Day. How many of you are wearing something green? Wonderful. I got mine on. Okay. Actually, I was looking for green socks, but I didn't have one, so I went for the necktie here. But on this beautiful day, we celebrate the spirit and ministry of St. Patrick, but at the same time, we celebrate all the living saints around us. And I am so glad we can come together to worship. Those of you who are worshiping with us online, good to see my good friends, and I hope you will enjoy our service today. And let us honor our God and celebrate life and love as found in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Shall we pray? Creator God, we glimpse your beauty in sunrise and sunsets, in mountaintop and eagle's wings. We sense your power in the mighty wind, lightning flash, and ocean's roar. Creator God, we come to praise you today. Now, precious Lord Jesus, we see your love stretching out to each and every one of us and beyond us. We stand in awe at your sacrifice, your pure self-giving love poured out for all humankind. So precious Jesus, we come to praise you. Holy Spirit, we see your power in lives transformed, hearts on fire. We listen for your still small voice, comforting, guiding, and calling us. Now, O Lord, we are here to worship you. So guide us, O Lord, to celebrate you in worship, in spirit and truth. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Okay, are you ready to do some good singing? If you are, would you stand where you are and sing number 519, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Thank you. Good morning. There's still time to join one of our Lenten book studies on the fruit of the Spirit. See Sandy after the service today if you are interested. Our youth are sponsoring two events this week. Today at 5 p.m., everyone is invited to a St. Patty's potato party in the social hall. Join us for good food and events such as a potato peeling contest, a pie competition, and a potato dish competition, and a scavenger hunt. Saturday, March 26th, from 9 to 5, there will be a workday fundraiser. Do you need some help with yard work, repairs, cleaning, and so forth? Our youth can help. Suggested donation is $15 per hour. If you're interested, you can contact the youth coordinator, Jess Vega. Also on Saturday, March 26th at 7 p.m., the care committee is planning to get a fun get-to-know-you gathering in the social hall with a crazy card night. Snacks are provided, but feel free to bring something to share. See Priscilla Cartwright after the service or contact the church office for details. Are you wondering what it means to extend a warm welcome to people of every gender identity, gender expression, and sexual orientation? You can learn more by joining the Rainbow Team members today in the church office after worship. In addition, Pastor Brandon will be holding a Zoom discussion on the Bible and human sexuality on Tuesday, April 5th, from 7:30 to 8:30 p.m. Please join us as we look more closely at what Scripture has to say about this important subject. Show your love for CUMC with a beautiful French Terry sweatshirt. Get yours from Alex and Associates in the social hall today after the service. The suggested donation is $25. And now for our children's time today, we are going to sing Praise Ye the Lord on a nice, beautiful spring day. This side will be Praise Ye the Lord. This side will be Alleluia. Stand up or put your hands up in the air when it's your turn. Praise ye the Lord, alleluia. Praise ye the Lord, alleluia. Praise ye the Lord, alleluia. Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord, alleluia. Praise ye the Lord, alleluia. Praise ye the Lord, alleluia. Praise ye the Lord. Not a single person stood up. We're taking the easy way out today. All right. Oh, Carl stood. Thank you, Carl. All right, now all the kids can come downstairs for Sunday school.
With gladness we pour.
Thank you, Kathleen. Now we are here to share some of our joys and celebrations as well as our earnest prayer list for yourselves or anyone you think about and all that. So let us share some of that. Just raise your hands if you want to celebrate something or thank God for something or like us to pray with you for someone or some causes, okay? Raise your hands, please. Oh, nice. Okay. I know many of you and I, we've been praying for the people and leaders of Ukraine, and we'll continue to do that. Many precious lives are being lost. The other day, I was watching a TV news, and I saw more than 100 strollers being displayed without the kids inside. So that really got me here, and I found myself on my knees in prayer. So anyway, let's continue to pray for peace, truly a peace, shalom and salam of our Lord. So for that, we'll say, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, that's good. That means I get to preach longer, is that what it is? But anyhow, I know, friends, you have your own prayer needs for yourselves and your loved ones. God listens to both spoken and unspoken prayers. So let us do that today, okay? Good. Kathleen, thank you for leading us in this time of prayer.
Good morning. Please join me in prayer. Oh, precious Lord, we come before you this day to lift our sorrows that might not have been mentioned today and our joys to your heart. We praise you and thank you for your generous love, your grace and your mercy for us and over our families. We lift up all who are on our weekly prayer list for healing and health. And we ask you to bless our church community during this time as we focus on being the welcoming church that God intends us to be. We pray for Pastor Brandon and Pastor Nolte as the work of their transition begins. We are all one with the world community. I would now like to offer up prayers for Ukraine. For many pastors leading their flocks at this critical time of decision and risk, they carry a heavy burden. For President Zelensky to remain strong and brave for his country, for protection of lives, but also for the church buildings that were built so sacrificially many years ago, may these churches be a beacon of light and safety. For protection of many children, parents, and older adults who will spend another night in bomb shelters, metro stations, or on the roads to safer places, and all the brave volunteers risking their lives to evacuate people. For the Lord to cause the opposing army to lose the will to fight, to be afraid, to be confused, or to use methods to stop the war and to know the truth. For the humanitarian efforts and the many volunteers who are setting up camps for refugees, feeding people, providing necessary funds, places for accommodation, and physical strength to serve. For many believers to stay strong, continue trusting the Lord, and not to give in to panic, fear, and desperation. We ask this in your holy name, O Lord. Now please join me in the prayer that our precious Jesus has given to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. We have three scripture readings this morning. The first one is from Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 9. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. And the last reading is from Ephesians 4, verses 1 to 3. I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us sing together one of our favorite hymns, actually. I Need Thee Every Hour, number 397. While we were singing together, Priscilla just whispered into my ear saying, Brandon, this is one of my grandma's favorites. I can still hear her sing. And I think that was a beautiful way of remembering your grandma. Let us pray. Oh, loving God, it's so good to be in your house of worship. And what a blessing it is to be able to sit and relax and enjoy the serenity of life a little bit here, but also to hear your message that calls us to life and hope and love. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your word. Now speak to us through this humble servant's mouth for all of your people in Jesus' name. Amen. So good morning. We've been hearing some good messages during this Lenten season under a new sermon series called Discover the Fruit of the Spirit. So we're going to talk today about two things, kindness and gentleness. How many of you can use some kindness and gentleness in your life today? Yeah. Sure, I need one too as well. Everybody needs it. So I begin with a little bit of humor that I picked up along the way. I'd love to listen to some great, wonderful, life-transforming and joy-generating kind of illustrations and so on and stories. Kindness, the question for you. Which famous TV host is renowned for her kindness? Uh-huh. Oprah, oh yeah, that's a good one. I have an answer for you. Ellen DeGeneres. Uh-huh. You don't know her. You know her. Yeah, DeGeneres. Okay. And someone said, his heart was heavy with pain, yet his kindness never faltered. I guess you could say that he had a heart of gold. That's for sure. So when you hear the words like kindness and gentleness, what comes to your mind? What are you thinking? What's your emotional response to that? Can you think of a person in your life right now who really has shown you kindness and gentleness? Can you think of someone? What did that person do for you? Just reflect on it. What caused you to think and say thank you for this wonderful friend or family member or colleague who have done that? When I was a youngster growing up in Honolulu, I lived not too far from downtown, so I got to see a lot of people there. And I really enjoy being there because whenever I go to certain stores, every owner is either uncle or auntie. That's how we interact with everybody. You don't have to share the same last name to be able to call that, but that's the way people kind of interact, and they always give you some extra stuff, like extra piece of cookie or what have you. So I've always enjoyed that. But I remember Mr. Lee, who was a school teacher, and he was obviously a very good teacher. So he decided to invite some of our young people, teenagers, to come and learn from him more. So he offered sort of after-school tutoring program. And he would invite me and my good friend, good buddy Lloyd, and several other kids. So we learned how to write properly and how to do math and things like that. He never used any word associated with faith at all. Never mentioned Jesus, never mentioned church, but his very act of kindness and gentleness caused me to want to have this desire to get to know him better, and that's how I got to know. So I still remember Mr. Lee, who was very generous in bringing cookies for us kids, and that was a good hook, and we all showed up and do that. So I learned a lot from him about how to write better and effectively. It's a great teacher he was. I'm sure you can think of many other persons. Could be a family member or next door neighbor and so on and so forth. So if you could define kindness, what would you say? I would say kindness is an attitude of the heart. In other words, we can choose to have this attitude of kindness in our hearts instead of choosing around this whole negative energy, like rudeness or unkind attitude. So kindness is an act, is an attitude of the heart, and you get to choose it. So I kind of did a little bit of research and try to figure out what does the Bible has to say about kindness. There were a whole bunch of things that we can look into. But kindness is one of the Spirit's noble fruits, as you see it in Galatians' account. The crushing of everything that is hard in our own life must have occurred if we are to proclaim the glory of kindness. Kindness is firmly united with the wisdom that is from above, which is pure, peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits. Do you remember the time when George Bush, the father Bush, was chosen as the nominee of the Republican Party back in, I think it was something like 1978, if my memory corrects me on that. But remember what he said in his sort of acceptance speech of his nomination as the president of the United States? He said, let's work towards a kinder and gentler nation. Do you remember that? That was his motto. And his motto really crossed the bridges across all political parties or economics and everything, a gentler, kinder, and the gentler nation. I'm still holding that up in my brain right at the moment as I think about my role as a peace-generating disciple of Christ and kind person that God is calling me to be for everybody else. The Apostle Paul states this way in Ephesians 2, 7, that God would show the immeasurable riches of grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. It's a beautiful phrase. Now, God's Spirit, working through the Scriptures, transforms our idea of who God is and what God does. Now, looking at God's kindness, we become kinder. Looking at God's wealth of mercy and grace enriches our own small, limited ability to be merciful and gracious to each other and others. Now, as seeing God's gentleness with us, we begin to treat others more gently, especially during this season of uncertainty. Treating everybody gently is very, very important. And I think that's one thing those of us who are followers of Christ can really do a better job at it. Now, kindness sounds like something you learn from a kindergarten class. How many of you grew up in a kindergarten, went to kindergarten? I did as well. Can you imagine, or can you think of this teacher there who is wagging her fingers like this and reminding us, make sure to be nice to each other. Don't fight. Treat each other with kindness. Be kind now, remember? I grew up hearing that quite a bit. Now, the discipline of kindness traces back to our own childhood. From the very beginning, we are taught and conditioned to be kind to one another. However, kindness goes much farther than simply saying please or thank you to people. These are manners, but we go a little bit deeper than that. Kindness comes from a heart posture of gratitude, but also sincerity in treating one another with respect and niceness and consideration. Here's a wonderful passage in Ephesians 2, verses 6 through 7, I read for you. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. So, kindness is more than an action when you interact with people. It is how you present yourself among many other people. Your character that shines through you can be dressed in the posture of kindness. I don't know about you, but as I add more wisdom, learn more wisdom about life itself, I prefer kind people than smart people. Actually, I'd rather have you tell others about your pastor here, this guy here, as a kind pastor, gentle pastor, loving pastor, rather than he's a smart cookie. So think about being kind toward yourself first and to others as well, because God is kind. Now let's go to a gentleness. When I was a not-so-rich seminarist, do you remember the little funny illustration I made last Sunday? You know, the young man who drove fast and claimed this old lady's car, the parking, and he comes out and says, you know, young and fast, and the old lady was not happy with it, so she decided to just bang the car, his car, with hers, and said, you know, old and rich. But here, it has a lot to do with how I see it. But when I was a student with limited, of course, income, because I was a full-time student, I used to go to a local church. It's a Methodist church, by the way, thrift store to buy shirts and other things that I need instead of buying something brand new. And I really, really liked the sign that said, gently used. The price was right, of course. So what does the Bible say about gentleness here? Gentleness is kindness in action. I repeat, gentleness is kindness in action. Gentleness is a response to our Lord's mercy and forgiveness and generosity. So I go to Ephesians 4, verses 1 and 3. It says this way, lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing it with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. This is a good phrase for us to think about, not only today, but every day. Going a little bit further in Ephesians 4, now verse 32 of the same chapter, it says, be gentle and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Now, as we have experienced God's forgiveness in gratitude, we ought to offer the same blessing to others. God's children are to live a life of gentleness. So I think there's a good reason for calling some of us men gentlemen. Gentlemen, that's a good phrase there. Our common misconception is that gentleness is a sign of weakness or a passivity. It's not. True gentleness is just the opposite. It requires great strength and self-control to be gentle. Gentleness comes from a state of humility. Therefore, someone who lacks gentleness is often prideful, easily angered, or fears the need for revenge, payback. Now, in order to be gentle, we must not view ourselves as better than someone else. Rather than asserting superiority along the line of our place of wealth, or even good looks, or even your education, we need to take a look at it in a new set of eyes. Rather than asserting our sense of pride and superiority, someone who is gentle wants to help other people, even when they have been done wrong things. An example of gentleness can be seen actually in the Gospel of John, chapter 8. I think you know the story. When the Pharisees brought this woman who was caught in adultery to Jesus, and they were ready to test out Jesus on this. The Pharisees told Jesus that the law of Moses commanded them to stone such a woman, to which Jesus now responding this way, verse 7. Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. And no one did. No one dared to do that. And after everyone left, Jesus did not go to the place of judging her. He did not condemn her and said to her instead, go now and live your life of sin. Through his gentle love, Jesus gave this woman a new life and brand new start. Just like how Jesus was gentle with the woman in this particular gospel story, God is gentle with us. Be reminded of the fact that God is gentle. Even in our sin, God continues to love us, and God does not keep record of our wrongdoings, but offers forgiveness if we come to our loving and forgiving God. Now, likewise, God wants us to be gentle to other people. Matthew 6, 14 and 15 says this way, "For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive you your sins." So a gentle heart comes from having love for others. This is shown in our thoughts and in the way we interact with those around us. So how do we grow in gentleness? It is important to have an accurate perception and understanding of what gentleness really is. It should not be seen as a weakness, but rather as a true strength, a true vitality of the Spirit. When we see it this way, we can begin to work towards becoming gentler. In addition, it is important to acknowledge the ways in which God is gentle with us. Our God is the Almighty Creator of the whole universe. And yet, this God is still gentle and loving towards us despite of our sinful nature. So finally, we can incorporate gentleness into our own lives, into our relationships, make it professional relationships or friendships, what have you. I think there's room for let gentleness come in and lead our way. Through prayer, for example, we can ask God to forgive us a spirit of gentleness and take away any feelings of self-righteousness or desire to go tooth for tooth and eye for an eye. We can ask the Lord to reveal ways we can show gentleness to others so that we may reflect God's divine character. So now that we understand the call to gentleness or gentle living, its big impact on our lives surely does, but how do we put it into action? I discovered maybe there are 10 ways to show some gentleness around. Let me give you a list of that. So thank you, Erica and Eric, for putting this up for me on the screen. Let's go through the 10 items here. Number one, be considerate of others' feelings and needs. When you do this, you can then look for ways to meet those needs and truly help work through those feelings. Be considerate. Two, show empathy. Empathy is acknowledging another person's point of view and to understand their feelings about, without judgment, that is. Number three, be patient. As Ephesians 4:2 says, be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. How about number four? Remember the golden rule. Treat others the way you like to be treated. Five, speak respectfully to everyone. Consider others as important and worthy of kind regard. Watch your tone so that what you have to say will be well received. Six, seek peace. Search for solutions and common ground. Seven, be a calm presence. And sometimes I use this phrase, and you've heard me mention it, offer a non-anxious presence. Number eight, act with tenderness and love. Nine, listen more than you speak or act. Remember, the ratio is 2:1. 10, be humble as you serve and care for others. I think the Spirit of Jesus is truly alive in these 10 options, and I invite you to consider that. So in closing, I'd like to make this note. Again, kindness is an attitude of the heart. Gentleness is the way in which this inner attitude is expressed in our outward action. Kindness and gentleness are so closely linked. They're like inseparable cousins, you know. It is impossible to have one without the other. So friends, God is kind, God is gentle. Likewise, let us strive to be kind and gentle to everyone in Jesus' name. So do you need some kindness? Get it from the Lord and let it guide your thoughts and your actions in Jesus' name. Amen.
Will the ushers please come forward to gather our tithes and offerings? We come now with praise and thanksgiving. We pray that you will bless these offerings and help us to use them to spread gentleness and kindness and your good news to our community and to the world. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
All right. Well, good morning, everyone. So you can just worship with us however you feel called to this morning. We're going to sing Yes, He Can.
Sometimes I wonder, is he faithful? Does he see me in my trouble? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. Can he rescue? Can he save me again and again? But when I look back, did he move every mountain? Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Oh, did he defeat the darkness? Did he deliver me? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Oh, yes, he did. Sometimes those voices try to tell me I'm forgotten and I've fallen too far from His hand. But I know what kind of God He is, and I'm trusting in His promises. I'm believing and I'm singing, yes, He can. Oh, did He move every mountain? Did He part every sea? Yes, He did. So yes, He can.
Yes, He can.
Oh, oh, oh. Did He defeat the darkness? Did He deliver me? Yes, He did. So yes, He can. Oh, oh, oh. Did He move every mountain? Did He part every sea? Yes, He did. So yes, He can.
Thank you very much. And also, Andrew, thank you for last night. Gave us a beautiful music presentation at North Huntington campus for our dinner church. And he's a good singer and a good writer, too, as well. So thank you. I just feel so blessed to have you and your daughter singing together. And also, Emily, we're so thankful for you guys.
Thank you.
And the rest of you, thank you, my friends, for your faithful ministry among us. Now, in light of the fact that we're celebrating St. Patrick's Day, I thought I'd do something St. Patrick-like. And this is St. Patrick's prayer, which I found, and I'd like to share that as our benediction today. Is that okay? All right, good. And those of you worshiping with us, friends and good neighbors, God bless you. Have a terrific week, and hope to see you again next week, okay? Take care. Good to see you all. Here's the prayer, and I offer you as the words of blessing to everybody. May the strength of God pilot us. May the power of God preserve us. May the wisdom of God instruct us. And may the hand of God protect us. And may the way of God direct us. And may the shield of God defend us. May the host of God guard us against the snares of the evil ones and against the temptations of the world. May Christ be with us. May Christ be before us. May Christ be in us, and Christ be over all. May your salvation, O Lord, always be ours, this day, O Lord, and evermore. Beautiful blessing, isn't it? Take this with you. So in the name of our God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, may you go with the Lord and share the great news with love and humility. Go in God's peace. Amen.
Because I've seen too much, now I can't see.